بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ثم أما بعد. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the especially merciful, we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon the most honored of all of the prophets and messengers, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, upon his pure family, his good companions, and all of those who follow them in righteousness until the last day. As to what follows, inshallah, before we begin talking about the fifth pillar of Iman, the fifth pillar, as I mentioned, of Iman, and that is the belief in the Day of Judgment, I wanted to share one hadith for some of you who are joining today that are new, and to serve as a reminder for myself, and then as an encouragement for all of you who are already coming. There's a hadith that was narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, as well as Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an, wherein they mentioned that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or peace be upon him, said, "Man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihahu fid deen." That whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for him, that He gives him understanding of the religion. That whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for, man yuridillahu bihi khayran, whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants khair for them, wants good for them in this life and in the next, He gives him an understanding of the religion. Now, there's a few things to note and that are important about this hadith. Is number one, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends good for people. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can intend good and want good for people. Another thing to note is that when He does want good for someone, He gives them understanding of the religion. And Allah, in the Prophet or the Apostle of Allah, he did not say He gives him a lot of the knowledge of the religion. He did not say He gets him to memorize the religion. He did not say He gives him a lot of information, but rather He gives him a good understanding of the religion. Because the word fiqh, it means to have a deep understanding of something, a well-rounded understanding of something, right? From different angles and perspectives. And when Allah Azza wa Jal, the exalted and sublime, when He wants good for someone, He gives them a good, well-rounded, deep understanding of the religion. And the fact that you brothers and sisters are coming here, that you took the time on a Thursday night when you probably got off of work, you may have had to find daycare, or you may have brought your children with you, or you, whatever other responsibilities that you had, you made time, you carved time in your life to come here. To do what? To learn your religion. To understand your religion. That in and of itself is an indication that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for you. Because there are other people that they will make excuses. And I'm not saying per se this specific class. Maybe there was another class they could have went to. But for one reason or another, they chose not to. Or there was another class on a different day that they could have gone to. But again, for one reason or another, they chose not to. This may be an indication, this may be a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want good for them. That an individual, be he brother or sister, young or old, that they somehow in their life find no time whatsoever from Monday to Monday, all of those days out of the week, and they have no time to learn their religion, this may be an indication that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want good for them. Because when Allah wants good for him, as the Apostle of Allah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, when Allah does want good for them, He gives them good understanding of the religion. And how can you get good understanding unless you learn? Is it possible, brother? Is it possible to get a good understanding of something unless you study that thing? It doesn't mean you have to study for 40 years. It doesn't mean you have to, right, memorize everything, but you have to know, you have to study something. There's going to have to be a little bit of sacrifice. There's going to have to be some kind of effort. And the beautiful thing about it, ayyuhal ikhwa wal akhawat, is that the effort that is required from us, wallahi, it's not a lot. Allah is not asking us for a lot. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. When they strive and they struggle, يعني you try your best. When you try your best and you put forth your best effort, right? Allah promises, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. As long as you are sincerely trying for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for His sake, to seek His face, to seek His pleasure, to seek His paradise, to seek His reward, to be protected from the hellfire. That's the reason why you're putting forward any kind of effort for anything. So long as you do that, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا, then Allah promises He will guide you to His path. And so those are just two things that I wanted to mention as an encouragement and a reminder for all of us, that us coming here, never underestimated, brothers and sisters. This small effort that you do of getting in your car, making time in your schedule, penciling that in, and making sure that you come, not just like I said, not just to hear specifically at Masjid Tawfiq North in this particular class, any class that it may be, that is an indication that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for you, because you're making time to learn about Him, about His rights on you, about what He wants from you, what is deserving from us to give to Him. And not only that, vice versa. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us in return, even though He is Rabbul Arsh al-Azim, He's the Lord of the Magnificent Throne, and in spite of that, what whenever we do our just due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which we can never really do our just due, but when we do what we're commanded, when we try our best, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He even gives to us. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned in the hadith of Mu'adh, where he said, Ya Mu'adh, أتدري ما حق الله على العباد وما حق العباد على الله. Look at the wording that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave here, again to illustrate how when we Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has rights on us, and when we fulfill those rights, we even have rights from Allah that He will even give us in return, as if it was some kind of transaction. He said to Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh, O Mu'adh, do you know what the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are on His servants? وَمَا حَقُّ الْعِبَادِ عَلَى اللَّهِ. And look at the words that he used. And he said, and do you know what the rights of the slaves are, the servants, are on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That if we didn't worship other than, if we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we don't associate partners with Him, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that is the right of Allah. And the right of us is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not punish us. And if you are not punished and you're not going to the hellfire, brothers and sisters, where are you going? If you're not going to the hellfire, where are you going? To paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the hellfire. And may He interest all of us into His paradise. Allahumma ameen. But again, these things, you come to know them, you come to understand them, when you make time for your religion, to learn your religion, and that's an indication and a sign that Allah wants good for you, and when you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you even more. Naam? And we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He bless us with knowledge that is beneficial, and that He benefit us by the knowledge He has already blessed us with, and that He protect us from knowledge that does not benefit. Allahumma ameen. Inna sami'un alim. Naam. Tayyib. So inshallah, we said we're going to start with, what did we say we're going to start with? What are we talking about today, Sheikh? The fifth pillar of Islam, huh? The fifth pillar of Islam? The fifth pillar of Islam? Of what? Of Iman. Oh, okay. The fifth pillar of Iman, of faith. Yeah, that's the one we're talking about. Huh? So what's the first pillar of Iman? Huh? أن تؤمن بالله. Just one. Jazakallah khair. The belief in Allah. Sheikh, what's the second pillar of faith? Second pillar of faith that makes you a Muslim. We believe in Allah. We believe in, what else do we believe in? In the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the messengers. Yes, that's one of them. Alhamdulillah. Huh, what's another one? And the belief in the angels, that's the second one. Huh, Rabia? What's one of the beliefs that the Muslims believe, one of the pillars? To believe in his books. And what else? That's how many so far? Huh? That's four so far. Pay attention, y'all. Huh? Belief in the Prophet. The Sheikh already beat you to it. Alhamdulillah. Now, come on now. These are the basic things that makes all of us Muslims. These are the things that you have to believe in order for you to even claim that you are Muslim. Everybody in here should know the answer. Belief in the last day, what we're going to be talking about today. Jazakallah khair. And the qadr, let's pretend like I don't speak Arabic. What is qadr? Destiny or fate. That everything that we do is ordained. It's already written by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Destiny. D-E-S-T-I-N-Y. I hope I spelled that was right, huh? Okay, tell you. Inshallah. So that's where we are. Belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Belief in the angels, his books, the prophets, the day of judgment, and the belief in qadr. This is important. Every last one of you, there should be no hesitation when you say this. There should be like no, wallahi, I'm not sure. The reason why they're called arkan. The reason why they're called arkan. Arkan is from the word rukn. A rukn is a pillar of something. A pillar. Right? And that's the plural. Arkan is the plural of rukn, which means pillars. Now imagine a house. Any of y'all ever worked in carpentry or construction? If you have, can a house stand without pillars? Can a building stand without walls? It has to have those. It has to have those. Likewise, in Islam, without those pillars, there is no Islam. And likewise, those pillars of Iman, if you don't have those pillars of faith, there is no faith. You could even believe everything else in Islam. But if you were missing one of those pillars in Islam, in Iman, excuse me, if you were missing one of those, there is no Islam. You could have memorized so many books. You could have learned so much of the religion. You could have even taken what they call ijaza, right? Which is almost like a certification from another sheikh who says you are qualified to teach this thing or to read this thing to others. You could take 100 of those. If you were missing one pillar of Islam, or excuse me, Iman, your Iman, your faith is deficient. And there is no Islam. This is the foundation, brothers and sisters. So this is, and for those of you who are mothers and fathers, you yourselves have to know and understand that so you can teach your children. Before you bring them here, before you bring them to a Saturday, Sunday school, before you bring them to a madrasa or a duksi, you have to be able to know that for yourself so you can tell your children. And if you're thinking about it, and if you're hesitating about the fundamentals, what about those things that are further out? If you're doing business, if you want to get married, or if you want to start some organization, anything that you want to do, you want to raise your children, you want to have children, you don't have them yet, and you want to know the Islamic rulings about how to raise children Islamically. If you don't know the pillars, I would be afraid for all those other things for you. So that's why even why we're having this class. So that all of you can understand and learn those, that we can go over it ourselves, even it's review for me. And for those of us who already know it, it's again, it's a refresher. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ ذِكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And give a reminder, because surely, certainly a reminder is beneficial for the believers. They'll benefit from it. They won't be like, nah, I already know all that. I'm beyond that. I'm already past that level, you know what I'm saying? No. This is about the kalam of Allah, the speech of Allah, the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They're always ready to hear that, even if they think they've already covered that. And then for those of us who don't know, alhamdulillah, now you know. Now, but to get what we're supposed to talk about today is about the Day of Judgment. And I just want to mention a few verses so that we can hear firstly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way that He speaks about this to hopefully set the tone about this discussion, inshaAllah. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says in the Quran, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدَرِهِ وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبْضَةٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. That they have not praised or venerated, meaning honored, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what is befitting, يعني what He is deserving of, while the earth entirely will be in His grip. Listen closely to that, brothers and sisters. The earth entirely will be in His grip on the day of resurrection, and the heavens will be folded in His right hand. Subhanahu, exalted is Allah, and high above, and He is high above that which they associate partners with Him. So on the day of judgment, the entire earth will be in His hands, and all of the heavens. So in all of its expansiveness, and how large it is, and how big it is, and how long it would take someone to travel, all of that. Imagine, all of that will be in the hands of Allah. Just the earth. And then the heavens, that it takes rocket ships with thousands and thousands of gallons of rocket fuel just to get out of here, to reach out to outer space. All of that space will be folded up and in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is just one of the things that will happen on the day of judgment. And then also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions, وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَسَعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ نُفِخَ أُخْرَى فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. That on the day of judgment, وَنُفِخَ فِيهِ الصُّورِ أو فِي الصُّورِ, that on that day a trumpet will be blown. And by the way, these different things, we'll go into details about them each. Like I said, I just want to set the tone from the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about this day. Ya'ani, the day of judgment. It says, on this day, there will be a trumpet that is blown in. And then everything that is in the heavens and on the earth, everything that is in the heavens, the birds, anything that flies, even if it's germs, whatever it might be, everything, and everything that is on the earth, will die. Illa man shaa Allah, except for whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. Except for whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. ثُمَّ نُفِخَ أُخْرَى فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. And then there will be another blowing of the trumpet. And then at that point, everybody will be standing up at that point, looking. They will all be standing up looking. Tayyib. And then I have just one more. And I think we can skip that. So basically, what is it to believe in belief in the last day? That it's the fifth pillar of Islam, Iman. And this is important too, brothers and sisters. Why we say it's the fifth? Because if you notice, when I asked around, some people said one thing and some said another of the different pillars of faith, but out of order. Generally, whenever it is mentioned in the Quran, generally when it is mentioned in the Sunnah, it is always mentioned in order. Or almost always, excuse me, it is almost always mentioned in order. Al-Imanu billah wa malaikati wa kutubihi wa rusuli wa liyum al-akhir min qadri khayri wa sharri. And another source that you can look at it where it's mentioned specifically in that order, belief in Allah, belief in the angels, and so on, is the hadith that we've mentioned every time that we've had the class covering the beliefs, and that's the hadith of what? The hadith of, what's that shit? The angel Jibril. The hadith of Jibril, it's commonly known as the hadith of the angel Gabriel. When he came to the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he came to the companions who were already sitting around the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, And he came and he asked him a number of questions. And it's a long hadith, and we've explained it a number of times, but you will find there one of the questions that he asked, yani the angel Gabriel, alayhi salam, when he asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ya Muhammad, akhbirni anil iman. O messenger, or O Muhammad, inform me or tell me about faith. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, an tu'mina billah, belief in Allah, the angels, the books, all the way to the end. But he mentioned it in order. So as best as you can, you should try, we should all try to remember it as best as we can in that order. Tayyim, does everybody understand that? Alhamdulillah, it is good that we try to, and it makes it easier to remember. Naam. And then also another evidence. So we said the hadith of Jibril is an evidence for why we believe in the last day. Another evidence is the ayah from Surah Al-Baqarah wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبْلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ إِلَى آخِرِ الْآيَةِ. In this ayah, in Surah Al-Baqarah, the second chapter of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ayah number, I want to say, it's not written here, but 185, I think 185, inshallah. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, laysa al-birr, righteousness is not, birr is righteousness, and it's all righteousness, right? It's an encompassing word. So every type of righteousness, being good to your parents, being good to your neighbors, serving your family, worship, every type of good. He said, لَيْسَ الْبِرُ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبْلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. Righteousness is not that you simply just turn your heads east and west. That's not righteousness. It's not just that. وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرُ, and then he said, rather, بِرُ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ. So the epitome of righteousness starts with belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The initial seed of righteousness, the righteousness that will benefit you both in this life and the next, because righteousness without belief in Allah is worthless. And in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's infinite generosity and fairness and justice, people who do righteousness without belief in Allah, they will still be compensated in this life. And he does it all the time. Don't you see, there are people who they give to the poor, they help, they're kind, they're gentle, they're nice to people. Allah gives them house, Allah gives them cars, they have children, they have so on and so forth, right? That is their compensation in this life. But without belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no true righteousness. It must stem from belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why he mentioned that righteousness, وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرُ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ. The first thing is belief in Allah. مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. And belief in the day of judgment. This is one of the things that is from righteousness. For us to believe in the last day. This is true righteousness. And then he goes on mentioning the rest of the beliefs. And then he mentions specific actions. And another point that I want to point out from that, something that always happens in Islam, in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is that faith and action are always put together, are mentioned together, because you cannot truly have faith without actions. Our Islam, our faith, is a dynamic faith. And actions are a part and parcel of our faith. Does that make sense? If you're really a believer, if you're really a Muslim, and if you really believe in Allah and the last day, you will do X, Y, and Z. You'll either pray, you will give sadaqah, you'll speak well or remain silent, you will do good things if you really are a believer. No. But again, to reiterate, I just mentioned two evidences and why we believe in the day of judgment, because Allah mentioned in the Quran, I just mentioned this verse, right, from Surah Al-Baqarah, and then also from the hadith of Jibril, which you can find in Sahih Muslim. Tayyib? Now, Something that is also important to understand about belief in the Day of Judgment, or the last day, is that without belief in the last day, as I already mentioned earlier, one's Islam is incomplete. Right? I mentioned if you're missing one of those pillars, your building is gonna, what's gonna happen to the building if there's a pillar missing? It's gonna be lopsided and eventually it's gonna collapse because there's too much pressure on something else, and it's gonna, the whole structure is compromised. And that's exactly how it is in Islam. Is that our iman, if you do not believe in the Day of Judgment, your Islam is compromised. And how do we know this? Again, from the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? وَخَيْرِ الْكَلَامِ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. That whoever disbelieves in Allah, and notice again, it's in order, again, the same order. Whoever disbelieves in Allah and the angels and the books and the messengers and the Day of Judgment, or the last day, excuse me, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, the last day, فَقَدَ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا, they have indeed gone far astray. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, not me or not someone else, but Allah is saying, someone who does not believe in one of these things, they are indeed far astray. It's not a light matter. It's not something easy. Be like, oh, it's inshallah, Allah ghafoor rahim. It's inshallah the sister will come around, or inshallah the brother, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this person is far astray. Again, be saying because there something is wrong with the foundation of their religion. Now, so if we wanted to summarize, what does it mean to believe in the last day? What does it mean to believe in the Yawm al-Akhir? Imam al-Marwazi, rahimahullah, he said, it's to have a firm conviction in your heart. To have a firm conviction in your heart that there is a resurrection after death. Meaning a physical resurrection, right? There are some groups, there are some religions, and there are some philosophies and things like that who would say that there is a day of judgment, or that there will be another time that we come back, but some people say it's only spiritual. Or some people will say that it will be on this world. That is not the case. We will die and we will come back physically. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring us back with our bodies and everything. Our minds, our heart, your skin, everything. It will be a physical resurrection. Tayyib. And not only that, but that there will be an accounting. It will be like, it won't look like a courtroom, but it will almost be like a courtroom. There will be a scale. There will be a judge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There will be witnesses. There will be a plaintiff, a defendant, somebody who's being accused. And all the things that they did, all of it will be brought before them. Everything that they did good, all of the things that they did bad, there will be an accounting. And there will be a weighing of those deeds. Are the good deeds heavier than the bad? Or vice versa, and that's going back to the scale. And then there will be reward and punishment. That everybody then, after the weighing of the deeds, and after everything has happened, they will be compensated. Whether it's reward for the good things that you did, or punishment for the things that you did. And then also, that there is a heaven and a hell, and to believe that everything and all of this was described by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about the Day of Judgment, because there is a lot more details about this. So in essence, what? Belief that we are coming back after the day, after we die, physically. And that there will be an accounting or a reckoning. That our deeds will be weighed, and so on and so forth. That there's heaven and hell. That there's punishment. And everything else that Allah mentioned in the Quran, and anything else that the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned in his sunnah, anything related to the Day of Judgment, all of that we have to believe in it. Let me give you some examples. So for example, there is punishment in the grave. This is related to belief in the Day of Judgment. There are questions in the grave. Munkar and Nakir. And all of these, we will talk about them, inshallah. But Munkar and Nakir, two angels will come and question everybody in the grave. This is something that you have to believe in. It's a part of the Day of Judgment. That there is a bridge that will be over the hellfire that everyone will have to cross. One is called a sirat, the other is qantara, but that both, that you will have to cross them. That there is a hold, which is like a pond, that is that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has, and that those people who are believers, they will be able to drink from this pond. And once they drink from it, they will never feel thirsty afterwards. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to drink from the hold of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma ameen. But all of these different details that are related to the Day of Judgment, we have to believe in all of them, so long as they're in the Qur'an, meaning the book of Allah, or in the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, some names. There are many names for the last day, or for the Day of Judgment. A number of different names. And in general, in Arabic, whenever something is like a really big deal, or something's really important, or really significant, in their life, in the past, the Arabs, they used to give that thing a lot of different names. Whenever something was very important or significant, Malachi. Whenever there was something very important or significant, they would give that thing many names. Let me give you an example. For example, a lion. Y'all know what a lion is, right? Of course, everybody knows. In Arabic, it's called Laith. It's called Asad. It's called Usama, and there are many other names for the word lion, right? Because it's a magnificent animal, and it's a very ferocious animal, right? And it's supposed to be like what? Like the king of the jungle, and so on and so forth. And especially if you were out there in the desert, right? But anyways, it was significant, and so they gave it many names. Likewise, something like a sword, the same thing, they give it many names. Likewise, the Day of Judgment, the last day, has many names. And just quickly, let me ask you, you all know some of the names of the Day of Judgment, other than the one that I've already said, the Day of Judgment, right? Can anybody tell me some names of the Day of Judgment? Huh? Yom al-Akhir, which means the last day. Meaning that after, yani, all of these days that we're living in our life, right, since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us and all of creation, that will be the last day of this earth. Then after, on the Day of Judgment. Then after that, excuse me, when everything will be recreated and so on and so forth, but this will be like the last day. Yawm al-Akhir, tayyib, jazakallah khair. What's another one? Say that one at a time. What was that, Sheikh? Yawm al-Qiyamah. And Qiyamah means standing, or the day of standing. Can anybody get, no, does anybody know why it's called the Day of Standing? What was that, sister? Because we're standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Does anybody know how long we'll be standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Prophet, it's mentioned. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, miqdaruhu khamsina alfa sana. It will be 50,000 years. That one day, that day of judgment, will be, he said, according to our counting, it will be 50,000 years. Naam, and it's also in the ayah, naam. Actually, I think I did. That's what I said. No, that's the ayah. Yes, you're right. Jazakallah khair. It's not a hadith. Naam, that's the ayah. I'm sorry. Naam. But al-muhim, the point is that what? 50,000 years we will be standing. Y'all ever stand in line at the DMV? Have you ever stood in line at the DMV? You ever stood in line when like the register is broken at the store? Or the person who's behind the cash register is like new and they don't know what they're doing? How do people start acting after about 2 minutes? After about 5 minutes? 10 minutes? If you had to wait at the hospital? Can you imagine having to wait for a whole day? Can you imagine having to wait for a week? A year? We can't even fathom what that would be like. 50,000 years, and every human being that's ever existed from our father Adam, everybody's going to be standing there. And everybody's waiting. We're all waiting for one thing. Even the people who are going to go to hell, the people who are disbelievers, because now they're observing and seeing everything. And it's all real now. Whatever the Muslims were saying, whatever the prophets were saying at their time, when they were informing them that there's going to be another day, even those people who are like, khalas, we were disbelievers, and we know we're going to hell, even they, because it's so long, they're like, khalas, we want the day of judgment to start. We don't care what's going to happen to us. We just want it to start. That's how long it's going to be. Even the people who know they're going to hell, they don't even care. That's how long it's going to be. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us on that day. Allahumma ameen. But now, you said Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of standing. Anybody know another name? Hold on, we got two brothers. Let's say somebody back here. Yes? Yawm al-Hisab. Hisab, taking account. Like we already said, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be weighing people's deeds. Everything that happened, everything will be taken to account. That nothing small, nothing is too insignificant that it will escape the judging of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on that day, His fairness and His justice will completely be shown to us on that day. That nothing too small will escape His judgment. That's why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, don't ever think that a statement is too small, that you don't pay attention to it. It could be that that statement could be something that makes you thrown into the hellfire, 70 kharifa, that it could take you like 70 leagues down into the hellfire by one statement because you said something wrong. But also something good, that the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned something so insignificant that nobody would ever think of. The Prophet ﷺ told the story of a woman from the children of Israel in their time. She was a prostitute. She was a prostitute. And most of you know what that is, and what type of lifestyle that must be. وَعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. This woman, she's walking, and she became thirsty and crawled down into a well. And she got some water for herself. Then comes out of the well and sees a dog that is so thirsty that it's licking the dust on the ground. And she goes back in the well. She goes back in the well. From her own shoe, gets a little bit of water. Can you imagine that, crawling down a well? Have anybody of you ever seen a well or been to a farm if you've ever seen a well? Can you imagine that? Have any of you ever done rock climbing? Imagine she's crawling down in a well. Imagine what that's like in a tight little hole that she's crawling down. Is she doing that for a dying baby? Is she doing that for an elderly woman? Is she doing that for, you know what I'm saying, a human being, for a dog? She's doing this for a dog. And she's crawling down and putting, you know what I'm saying, that, can you imagine that? And she's got her shoe in her mouth to hold the water, and then she's going to come back out. Nobody sees her. Nobody's watching her. There's no Facebook, you know what I'm saying, like, look at me, y'all, look at what I'm doing. There's no Snapchatting, you know what I'm saying, so she can let everybody know what she's doing. There was no website, give me like 50 likes. Nobody's there. That's just between her and a worthless, nameless, nobody knows of dog. But because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in spite of what she used to do, but because of something that was in her heart, because of her sincerity, she could only have been doing that for Allah. Allah will enter into paradise for that. So something even so small, we think of it, maybe think of it as insignificant to our eyes, but to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this reminds me of some The statement of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna Allah la yanduru ila suwarikum wa la ajsamikum, walakin Allah yanduru ila qulubikum wa a'malikum." That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He doesn't look at your shape or your body, like how big you are and how strong you are, or how slim or sleek or whatever, you know, because we pay attention to that, right? That's important to us. Maybe before we go out, we make sure hair's, you know, everything's nice and right. We take time and cologne and perfume, etc., right? But Allah doesn't look at that. He looks at what is in their, لَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ, but He looks at your heart. So what must have been in that woman's heart when she was climbing down that well? وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ, and He looks at your deeds. And obviously you can see, the Prophet ﷺ, he's telling us what the deed was, her climbing down that well. But because on Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive her for her sins. And we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for our sins. But now, it is the Yawm al-Hisab. The point that I wanted to bring out is that no matter how small it is, something bad that you do, or how good, but even if it's seemingly small, all of it, the big and the small, the things that were done in secret, the things that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew, good or bad, the things that you thought that you got away with, all of that will be brought to account. And that's why it's called Yawmul Hisab. Tayyib. But for the sake of brevity and time, I'm just going to mention some other names, right? It's also called the Day of Reckoning or the Day of Recompense, meaning that everybody will be compensated. It's also called the Catastrophe, because of some people, it will be this, that's what it will be for them, is a huge catastrophe that they have to come back. Again, you can imagine you were sleeping for God knows how long, maybe hundreds of years. And then all of a sudden, there's something compelling you to crawl out of your grave. That's a huge catastrophe. Tayyim. And then the inevitable day, the Day of Standing, which was already mentioned. And there are a number of other names, right? But these are just some of the names that it is called. So what does belief in the last day entail? There are some components or like moving parts to our belief in the Day of Judgment, right? Namely, there are three. There are namely three things that we have to, or that we know and understand when we talk about belief in the Day of Judgment. The first thing are that there are signs of the hour, both major and minor. Signs of the hour, alamat as-sa'a, or ashrat as-sa'a. There are signs that are both major and minor that precede the Day of Judgment. Meaning what? The Day of Judgment hasn't happened yet, but there are signs and indications that it's coming while we're still in this life, right? So that's one component, the signs of the Day of Judgment. And those are broken up into two categories, major and minor. Signs of the Day of Judgment, major and minor. Then there's another point, once you die, which is the barzakh, or life in the grave. And that also has two parts, whether it's punishment or reward. Life in the grave. And then thirdly is the actual resurrection itself, the actual Day of Judgment itself. And then everything that has been described either by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and everything thereafter until your feet are squarely planted in the paradise or in the hellfire. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala place us all in Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la. Allahumma ameen. So I mentioned three parts. Can anybody tell me what they are that entail belief in the Day of Judgment? Can anybody tell me? Y'all brothers asleep. Look at the sisters already taking an answer. SubhanAllah. Naam, please say that again. Okay, the signs of the hour, major and minor. And remember, this is before the Day of Judgment starts. Tayyib. Oh, no, khalas, I want to see one person say all of them. Naam, sister. Life in the grave, punishment and reward. There are some people who will be punished, and there are some who will receive reward. Naam. And there will be some who will get both. Because from the punishment is like the squeezing of the grave. Now, طيب. And the third thing, sister? The actual day of judgment itself and everything after that happens after that. From the judging, from the people seeing, from the believers seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the Maqam al-Mahmud, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with du'as and prayers and names and attributes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has never taught anyone before that day. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will use those names and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to initiate and start the day of judgment. Na'am. And there's also the hold, and we said the qantara, and the sirat, and all of these different things. There are a number of different things that will happen. Now I need a brother, somebody to represent the brothers who can say all three of them. Now you've heard it like three times at least now. Sheikh Mustafa. Sheikhuna. Bismillah, all three of them. Can you tell us? Oh, no, say the same way in order. But that's one of them, yes. Tayyib, give me what you got, Shaykh.
The day of judgment itself,
Tayyib.
Punishment or reward in the grave.
Life in the grave.
The major and minor signs.
That was all three of them. You just said it backwards. Tayyib Sheikh, you said you didn't have all of them. Alhamdulillah, you know more than you think. MashaAllah. May Allah increase you, akhi. Allahumma ameen. Tayyib. So now, belief entails three different things. Belief in the day of judgment. The signs of the hour, major and minor. And that's in this life. Life in the grave itself. And whether that's going to be punishment or reward. And lastly is the day of resurrection itself and everything that happens in that. Tayyib. So now, inshallah, we have about 3 minutes before we stop. So I just wanted to mention something quickly here. That inshallah, that I forgot to mention. Number one is at the end we will take, and now there seems to be more people, so we will take between 5 to 7 questions right afterwards. So if you have any questions now, you can go ahead and ask now. If not, if you can write them down. If it's directly related to the topic. But does anybody have any questions now? Yes, directly related to the topic? Tayyib. But otherwise, if we can save them till the end, right, we'll leave some time for between 5 to 7 questions. And then, but I only want to cover one more thing, is just mentioning some of the minor signs of the Day of Judgment, and then the rest we will leave for next week, inshallah. But yes, sister, and then the brother, and then we'll move on. Yes. Yes. No.
That always kind of confused me. It's a sign of what's to come.
No. Okay, so the sister mentioned, just for clarification, she said that she heard two different things. One, that life in the grave, those people who are being punished in the grave, that it's an indication about what's going to happen to them to the actual day of judgment. So if they were being punished, that must mean they're going to the hellfire, right? And also, she heard that if they are read, that them being punished in the grave is an expiation for sins, right? So that on the day of judgment, that they wouldn't be punished. Something that we have to understand, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, "Inna Allah tayyib, la yaqbalu Allah illa tayyib." That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pure. He is good and pure. And he only accepts that which is good and pure. Now there's a number of things that we understand from this, right? Firstly, that for example, if you want to make da'wah, if you want to do some type of ibadah or some act of worship in Islam, right? It is not enough that you have good intentions, right? Or that you do something haram, for example, and that you say, I have good intentions, right? Allah knows my heart, right? Because Allah only accepts that which is pure. So if you're doing something impure with good intentions, like we don't have Robin Hood in Islam, right? You steal from the rich and then give to the poor with the intention that I'm doing something good here. We don't do that because Allah is pure and he only accepts that which is pure. Likewise, on the day of judgment, only people who are pure will be able to enter Jannah. You cannot have sins and enter paradise. There is no way. There is no way that you will enter paradise because Allah is pure and he only accepts that which is pure. And in his paradise, only the pure will enter his paradise. Tayyib? We understand that point so far? That only the pure will enter paradise. There are some people who will go directly to paradise, right? They will go directly. And they won't even have to go through, right, the difficulties that everybody else has to go through. For example, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned about the Mujahideen that they will not have to go through the difficulties in the grave and so on. They will go straight to Jannah. There are other people who, because of the scale and the weight of their deeds, mashallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on them and enter them to the paradise straight away. There are some people who are Muslim. I'm only talking about the Muslims so far, okay? I'm not talking about non-believers or other people. Just the Muslims right now. There are some who will leave this life having major sins, right? Or having done small sins, but they never made tawbah for those sins. They never repented and returned back to Allah and said sorry to Allah and asked for his forgiveness. And so in doing so, they have left this life and they are not clean. They are not pure. And so some of them, they will be punished in the grave as a way of expiating some of their sins and wiping some of that impurity that they have on them. And unfortunately, they have to be cleaned in the fire. Then coming to the, for some people, that will be enough. That's enough. And then khalas, that cleaning, that purification was enough in the grave. But for some, it still wouldn't be enough. And then on the day of judgment, they will go through difficulties. And then for some of them, it will be on the qantara, the bridge that I mentioned that they have to cross. Right? The Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned when he described that bridge that it's a haddu min as-saif wa adaqu min ash-sha'r, that it's sharper than the edge of a sword and that it's thinner than the strand of a hair. And when crossing that bridge, again, according to people's sins, those who have less sins, they will be able to cross the bridge. Those who have no sins, excuse me, they will be able to cross it as fast as a strike of lightning. Some will cross it as fast as a wind, but those people who are impure, they still have sins that they're carrying on them. It will be very difficult for them to cross that bridge. And even the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned like kalalib, like hooks that will grab on them and rip at them. And then some of them, they will fall in the fire. Wa'iyadu billah. May Allah protect us from that. And then while they're on that bridge, and then they will fall off. These are still Muslims. We're still talking about Muslims. They will have to be in that fire, yani, to be purified. So that ultimately that they can be what? So that they can be pure. And then they will be taken out of that fire and go to Jannah. But there are other people who, khalas, yani, they will be punished in the grave. They will be punished during the day of judgment itself. Like everything will be suffering for them and will be difficulty for them, right? And all of those difficulties, it should be a purification for them. But there is some impurities that if you leave this life with that impurity, you cannot wipe it off. And that's shirk. That is an impurity that you cannot wipe off. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushrika bihi wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha." That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does not forgive shirk. That is one thing that if you don't make tawbah, meaning you don't repent from that, yani, and embrace Islam. Or if you were making some kind of shirk as a Muslim, that you don't repent from that and turn away from it. If you continue to do so and you die as such, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, I don't forgive that. And in a hadith Qudsi, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَنَا أَغْنَى شُرَكَائِي عَنِ الشِّرْكِ, that I am rich, I am free from, I don't need somebody associating partners with me. وَمَنْ أَشْرَكَ بِي, and whoever associates partners with me, تَرَكْتُهُ وَشِرْكُ, then I leave him alone. He's impure, I don't need him. He's unclean, he's dirty, or she's filthy, I don't need them. And they will not be clean on the Day of Judgment. If they associate partners with Allah and die on that, meaning if you die as a non-Muslim, and after the advent of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you die as a Christian, or a Jew, or a Magian, or any other thing, that is an impurity that cannot be washed off. And it cannot be burned off. And it cannot be unclean. And that's why those people, they will be permanently. So, to get directly at your question, there are some people, it will be a source of purification for them. For some, it will be enough. And khalas, they won't be punished later. There are others that, no, khalas, be punished here, and khalas, they're going to be punished in the hellfire. And obviously, for those who are non-Muslims, yani khalas, in the grave, they'll be punished. On the Day of Judgment, it's going to be difficult. And then khalas, in yom, after the Day of Judgment, in the hellfire, khalas, and that's for eternity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the hellfire. Allahumma ameen. Tayyib, ya ustaz, you said your question. Inshallah. Inshallah, can we limit it to one and then we can save at the end, inshallah.
Okay, the other one intention I put it back, you know, the main important things I want.
No.
How can we protect our life to whispering of shaitan to protect ourselves? What should we read always?
No. So we tried to say if we could limit the questions that are directly related to the topic. Inshallah, we can ask that. Maybe we can come back to that at the end, inshallah. Is the other question related to the topic? Tayyib, bismillah.
The other one is how can someone who have intention and pray, he like pray on time, and reading the Quran is not perfect, and he tried to learn how he is just doing his learning of his Quran and when he's praying his prayer.
Naam. Can you rephrase the question?
Yeah, my question is,
no.
He like praying on time.
He wants to pray on time.
Yeah.
No.
The way he praying wasn't learned, just he learned, you know, the way they are praying people, it wasn't right.
No. Okay. Yeah. So then?
Yeah. And when he read the Quran,
it's not good.
Exactly, yeah.
No.
And how is that prayed? Does he have the intention?
No. Tayyib. So he said, okay, somebody is praying, but their prayer is not exactly, yani they didn't learn it. They just kind of like observed and watched other people and kind of like copied them. And likewise with the recitation of the Quran. First of all, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. That's seeking knowledge of sacred knowledge of the religion. Allah said, His Messenger said, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the Sahaba said, you know, the scholars of Islam. This is an obligation on every Muslim without exception. Man, woman, rich, old, young, poor, my sheikh was mufti of my country or my village or whatever, it doesn't matter. Everybody has to seek knowledge. And when that was explained and elaborated on by Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and others as well, when they explained, what does that mean? For example, one of the students of Imam Malik, he said, is it what we're doing here? They were studying hadith with him, which is a specific science in Islam. Imam Malik, he said, no, not what we're doing here. Yani, this is a specialized knowledge. Not everybody has to do this. That's not what the Prophet ﷺ meant. He said, "Ma yakumu bihi dino." Some what he needs, they have to learn what they establish their religion on, which would include the salah and the recitation of the Quran. Tayyib. So now, someone he doesn't necessarily pray well, or so on and so forth, right? It is an obligation on them that they need to learn how to pray properly. It is not enough that you just watch other people and observe other people, because they might be doing it wrong. They might be mistaken. So the first thing I would advise that person is that they need to go to a teacher and learn how to do that. If that's not readily available and accessible, which we are making that available here, But inshallah, if you're not able to do so, or that person, individual, may not be able to, there are plenty of books and there are plenty of videos that show how to pray the salah. But I would highly, discourage just watching videos to learn your religion. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, like, the most valuable thing to us, the most important thing to us should be our faith. That should be the most valuable thing to you and the most important thing to you. And wallahi, one of the saddest things, in my opinion, to see is that our religion is being cheapened to the degree that brothers and sisters think that they can properly learn the religion like just from like videos, like YouTube videos. When nothing, you would never do that for anything else. Nobody would ever say that they're an expert in kung fu from watching YouTube videos or DVDs. Nobody would ever say that. Nobody would ever say that this person is a master barber from watching a DVD. Nobody would ever say that. Like, but if he went to school and he set up under a master and somebody who taught him, then he can be a master barber. Isn't that right? Then he can open up a shop. Look, and I'm saying something as mundane as cutting somebody's hair or something like, you know what I'm saying, like a martial art. Even medicine. Would you ever let someone operate on you if he told you, don't worry, I got this. Inshallah, we're going to do open heart surgery. I watched like more than 1,000 hours of videos on YouTube. Would you let him operate on your heart, akhi? Would any of you do this? Like, no. You want to know that he what? That he went to school, sat with masters, other doctors with degrees who know what they're talking about. And then on top of that, certified by a board of what? Other doctors. The same way with the religion. From day one, it has always been that way. There was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then after him were the Sahaba, Ibn Abbas, he went in Taif, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he went to another region, and other Sahaba, Mu'adh ibn Jabal went to this region, and the people would come to them, to teachers, to learn. And then after them was the Tabi'een. Same thing, they had teachers. Sufyan al-Thawri, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, right? And others. But there was what? There was always teacher, student, always like this. Even when you want to get a master's degree, which is funny, right? When you want to get your master's and your PhD, that's exactly what they do for you, right? When you want to become an expert at something, what do? You get someone who is a master or at that field, and just you and him, one-on-one, and he's overseeing your dissertation, and he's advising you, and he's giving you pointers, and he's showing you like this. And then only after he says it's okay, then, right? Those are the mundane worldly things. Our faith, which is more important than all of those things, and we relegate it, be like, wallahi, akhi, inshallah, I know there's a halaqah at the masjid, or I know there's something going on, but I'm gonna just stay at home and just watch, yani. You can't ask questions. You can't, even if you misunderstood something, you can't, right? I'm not saying those are worthless. I'm not saying that. As you can see, we're recording them and hopefully putting them so that people can benefit from it. But the point here is, what, that shouldn't be like your primary source, especially something like your salah, which is from the word sila, which means your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn from a teacher. Likewise, the recitation of the Quran. Don't relegate it to an app on your phone. Your religion is far more worth, or is worth more than that. It is more valuable than that. And only when you treat it as such will you get value from it. Tayyib? I hope that makes sense. But the short answer, what? Yes. Teacher, right? And and especially for the salah, which is the basics, akhi, if you need to, brother, we also want to make you know that you're more than welcome to come here, inshallah. Or if anyone that you know who's going through that, they're more than welcome to come here, and we'd be happy to show them and teach them and hook them up with someone who will go through that with them. But inshallah, it seems like we're khalas opening for the questions. So inshallah, I think I will stop here. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wa akhira da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. So inshallah, we will continue next week still talking about the Day of Judgment. So if you want to know what are we going to be covering next week, we're going to be covering some of the major and minor signs that are happening. and then talking about the journey of the soul, يعني, when it actually starts, when you die, and then we're going to actually go through that process. This is the hadith of Bara ibn Azib. It's a very long hadith where the Prophet ﷺ mentioned from the moment you are on your deathbed all the way up until the day of judgment, and then which is called life in the grave, and then the blowing of the horn, and the weighing of our deeds, and we'll cover those next week, inshallah. Tayyib. So we'll open up for questions, and then after that, it seems like there's going to be some announcements after, inshallah. Tayyib, oh, shoot. But we're going to ask the questions first, and then we'll announce. I'll announce, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Tayyib. So if any of you have to leave now, inshallah, alhamdulillah, ahlan wa sahlan. But if you want to stick around for the Q&A, same thing, ahlan wa sahlan. Now, if you could have one and then someone else, and then if we need, we can come back, inshallah, if you don't mind. As long as you really want to learn, no question is silly. Yes. Yes, of course. No. So two parts to that, right? The first thing that we all understand is that Allah is Al-Hakim. He's the all-wise. Or excuse me, the just judge. Al-Hakim, the just judge. Likewise, Al-Adl, and he's Al-Hakim, the all-wise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have to always keep that in mind when we think about these different things. For example, right? What about children who pass away? What will happen? Even if you don't know necessarily exactly what will happen, go back to your faith that you know Allah is just and fair and He would never do anybody wrong, ever. People do. People forget. People get angry. People want to get you back. People, what? But Allah, He's fair and just. So, now, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is expecting that we're all going to have to stand 50,000 years, right? Allah is going to be fair and just, right? So you should always keep that in mind. Now, specifically about the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, excuse me, is going to recreate everyone. It will not be the same as we are now. It will not be the same as we are now, right? That we will be able withstand those things. It doesn't mean that it's going to be pleasurable for us, but yani that we'll be able to withstand it. Tayyib? But now, so they won't be sick and infirm but does that make sense? That He will recreate us. So that it won't be the same like we are now. So those who are elderly and sick and weak and so on and so forth, it won't be the same on the Day of Judgment. No. Is there another question? I think the sister raised her hand first, and then actually if we can give a chance for the brothers after that. Yes, sister. How about this? Are there any more questions related to the topic? Because I would prefer to give precedence to those than anything outside of that, then we can give that. So, Tayyib, yes. Oh, but you just asked a question. Khalas. Sheikh Ibrahim. Assalamu alaikum. Yes, fadl. Will they have to go through the Day of Judgment? Under the age of what? Five. Yes. There will be a different judging for them, right? And there will be a different judging for them. Some of the scholars, they say that there will be a different judgment for those people who never heard of the message, those people who were mentally not sound, whether they had some kind of mental deficiency, or they were insane, or they were, senile, or whatever, like they were so old when they finally someone told them the message of Islam or whatever. And with him, those people, they will be brought on the day of judgment, right? And they'll be given a judging where they will be told to jump in a fire. They'll be told to jump in a fire. And if they jump, if they obey the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be cool and easy for them. Right? Same like it was for Ibrahim alayhi salam when he was thrown in the fire. And then if they don't, if they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it would be that had they had the opportunity in this life, they would have disobeyed anyways, and then they'll be thrown in the fire. That's one thing. Another say is that, Allahu ta'ala a'lam, that they will follow their parents, whatever their parents did, right? If their parents were believers and they passed, then they will go with them. But inshallah, we will talk about the details of that, inshallah, with the, when we talk about the life in the grave, inshallah. No. But, no. About the topic, sister? No? Okay. Hold on. Anybody else? No? No? Okay, Tayyib. The sister, and then and then she will be the last one, inshallah. No brothers, mashallah. Y'all know everything, huh? Alhamdulillah. Or I just did such a good job that, like, khalas, y'all don't have no questions, huh? Okay, alhamdulillah. Tayyib. No.
So let's say a moment of a Muslim wants to go to Jannah, and you know in Jannah you get anything you're granted anything you wish for. So what if they wish for their non-Muslim parent or non-Muslim sibling or spouse or child or just a non-Muslim that was in the dunya?
Mm. You don't get it whatever you wish, right? So, for example, you can't ask for bad things, right? You were mad at somebody in this life, and then you saw that they're in paradise, and you'd be like, well, they did me wrong. Oh, Allah, I want, you know, something bad to happen to that person. It doesn't operate like that. No. Right, I was just giving an example. This is, though, even the prophets, Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salam, will come on the Day of Judgment asking for his father. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already informed us in the Quran that he will not. His father Azar, he will not allow him to go to paradise. Because he committed, not only did he commit shirk, he was a shirk manufacturer. He used to produce idols in his house. Not only that, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his own uncle, Abu Talib, and his own parents, the parents of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't even have to go to his uncle Abu Talib, who he loved dearly, and who raised him and protected him and protected Islam. And to be quite frank, brothers and sisters, he probably even did more for Islam than any of us sitting here, Abu Talib. But he did not believe, he did not proclaim his faith. He did not say, I believe in, even though he knew that he was the Prophet. But Abu Talib, he will not go to paradise. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even described that he will be punished, and what his punishment would be. And he loved him. And not only did he love him, he even sacrificed and even protected Islam. Abu Talib did. But even the parents of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once there was a sahabi, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he asked this question. He said, where will my parents be on the Day of Judgment? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right, because he knew that they had already passed and they were not believers, he said, they will be in the hellfire. And this made the man sad. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he saw that it made him sad. And when he was turning away, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told him, but that's where my parents will be too. The parents of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best of creation, the most beloved to Allah azza wa jal, even his parents, who died as not as Muslims, as non-believers, they will be in. If anybody had right before any other person, for their parents or their relatives to go to Jannah, it would have been the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But even his own mother and father, they won't be. So no one else will have that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that he has made Jannah for those people who have made shirk, he made it haram for them. And so, but the thing about us getting whatever we want is in paradise is anything that is good. And if you think about it, sister, that is not good. Somebody who committed the greatest crime, for them to get to go to paradise with all of the people who have sacrificed and done so much, that would be unfair. That wouldn't be fair. And we said what? That Allah, so we started by saying that what? Allah is just and fair. Think about, and let me give you an idea. I hope I'm not going too far on a limb, but think about like communism and socialism, right? Where the idea is that what? We're in a commune, right? And we all work together, right? And we all share in what we have. But no matter how much you work, and no matter how little I work, we all get the same. In our human nature, if I work 13 hours in a day, and I'm healthy and I'm strong, and there's somebody else who's just as healthy and just as strong as I am, and they work 5 hours in a day, would any of you, would you say that's fair? Would you say that's fair, Nuseiba? I'm working 13 hours and somebody else is working five? And then not only that, okay, they're working, that's okay, maybe that's fair because maybe that's what he's choosing and that's what I'm choosing. But then I get compensated and he gets compensated, the same compensation. Is that fair, Nuseiba? That is fair? He gets the same and he only worked 5 hours and I worked 13? That's fair? It's not fair. And any of you, you would not like that. You would look at him and be like, but I worked 13, how come he's getting the same? I should be getting more. That is our human nature. That's how we are built. That's how we are hardwired. The harder you work, the more you expect to be compensated. And the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has designed this deen, that the more, if you want the best of paradise, you gotta work for it. There's different levels to Jannah. And it would not be fair that someone who committed shirk, he committed the greatest crime that you could ever commit. And then this person, all Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who gave everything from his wealth, right? Sumayya, right? Sumayya, who died. She was the first martyr in Islam. And she's sitting there after all she gave her life for Islam. And here's this non-Muslim who didn't even believe in Allah, and we're in Jannah together. How would that be fair? Hadha shay'un akhar. That's a different question. Hadha shay'un akhar. But you said a disbeliever. I'm just answering that question. Even if you just think about it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned specifically in the Quran that He has made it forbidden for those people to enter Jannah. So I hope that answers the question. Now, actually, we already said this sister, and then that sister, and then if you want, we can talk afterwards, inshallah, there, inshallah. But yes, sister, Shayla. Now, you said you had a question? I'm sorry, I didn't. Could you repeat that, please?
What if you wish to visit them in the hellfire, just like just to visit, just to talk, and then come back? Like,
just reverse it? No, it's not a silly question at all. Any question that someone is sincerely looking to learn, never think that it's a silly question. If you're sincerely trying to learn, if you're trying to get some laughs, if you're trying to get, right, whatever, or waste time, or you're trying to ask a question that you done already heard 47 other sheikhs speak on, and you just want to get the 48 because you're looking for something, that's silly, and that's a waste of time. But if you're sincerely trying to learn, no question is silly. No question. If you are sincerely trying, because why do you want to know? Because you want to get closer to Allah. And that and getting closer to Allah, is that ever silly, brother? Is that ever silly, brothers? Sisters, is that ever silly? No, that's never. Never is. Tayyib. But about your question, though. Think about it like this. Right now, we don't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All right? Right now, we don't see Him. This life is a process of us trying to build within ourselves and inculcate within ourselves through the system of Islam a love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beyond anything else. More than anything else. That's when you don't even see Allah. All right? You're trying, By your praying, by your coming to the halaqah, by you teaching your family, by you watching those videos, by you attending conferences, by you putting on your hijab, by you fulfilling the commands, by as much as you can make it staying away from the prohibitions, by you making tawbah when you make mistakes, by you returning back and leaving those wrong things that you knew were wrong, that you should have left a long time ago. And then you come back to Allah and you're doing your best. All of that is what? Is because you're trying to love Allah more than anything else. Now, on the day of judgment, khalas, you've arrived at that time. At that point, you will see Allah after all this stuff that we're going through in this life. After all the things that we have to deal with, all the difficulty, all the rejection, the sicknesses, the children dying, the wars, the plagues, the you didn't have enough money at the time, the rent wasn't enough, the people told you no, they didn't like you, or it was too much, like all of these different things that we have to deal with in this life. On the day of judgment, if you go to Jannah, it was like you were getting everything that you ever wished for. Just you being able to go to Jannah and you seeing Allah. Because that was the whole reason why you were doing it in the first place. But to see Him. And then you get to see Him. 60 years, 70 years you go through this life. And not everybody got money in their pocket. Not everybody lives on a house on the hill or got a silver spoon in their mouth. And even those people, they be depressed. They be wanting to commit suicide. They be throwing all their money away. For everybody, we're going all through that. And then if you were a believer, you are actually seeing now why you went through all of that. It's all actualized there that you get to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَ. That their faces will be brightened on that day and they are gazing upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said there will be nothing more pleasing on that day than that. That is the best reward that you can get. More than anything, and you will want that. That will be the most pleasurable thing to you. More than anything else. Now, when it comes to, can I see this other person again? You will understand. It will all click for you at that time. That person who's there, I love Allah more than anything else. I'm sorry, you had all the ample opportunity. You had the chances. You had the opportunity to come back. You had the chance to make tawbah. You had the chance to embrace Islam. You had the chance to come to the truth. You made mistakes, and then you had, like, all of that will click for you that day because you're observing on the day of judgment. You're watching everything unfold. Like, right now, we're only discussing about the mercy of Allah, the justice of Allah, and so on and so forth. Sometimes it's hard for us to digest because we see what's going on in Syria. You might question yourself, like, why is Allah allowing that to happen? Where's the justice? Or what's happening in Burma? Or even poor people. It doesn't even have to just be Muslims. Non-Muslim. Why does a woman get, you know what I'm saying, assaulted? You'd be like, but on that day, when everybody who ever did anything wrong, and you see all of the justice being played out by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you'll understand and it will click. And so if somebody's in hellfire, in the Quran, Allah describes it, you'll say, y'all had your chance. They will actually communicate with each other. The people who are in paradise and the people who are in the hellfire, they will actually communicate with each other. And the people in the hellfire will be like, please, just give us some water. Just give us some. And they're going to say, you had your chance. You had your opportunity. They'll even conversate with the angel, Malik, Khazin al-Nal, the one who's stoking the fire. They'll even have conversations with him. And he's going to say, didn't somebody come to y'all? Didn't somebody tell you? So at that point, sister, you will understand and you won't have that in you, right? Because the most important thing to you is that you see your Lord and that you yourself are in paradise. In this life, we hope that those people who are non-Muslims, those who are our cousins, those who are our brothers and sisters, those people who, you know what I'm saying, those people that you see at the barbecue, at the family reunion, those people that you have to go and see on the holidays or whatever, those people who your mom and your dad, that's why it's so important that you learn Islam so that you could talk to them, so that you can tell them, because you're the best person to make da'wah to your uncle. You're the best person to make da'wah to your cousin. You're the best person to make da'wah to your people. The best when you learn your deen. But if you don't, then Allahu musta'an, there's really not too much you can do. But when you learn your religion, then hopefully we can avoid that ugly scene and scenario that on the day of judgment, that we would have to see our family members or our love. And subhanAllah. And I'm not trying to say this like in a cavalier fashion. As I already mentioned to you, even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his lifetime, he had to feel that sting, where he was crying, he's begging his uncle, please say, please just say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Like one word, just that one word, that I can have something that I can go to Allah with. Even he will have to feel that. Even the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, he has to feel that. Even Prophet Nuh alayhi salam with his son and his wife, he'll have to feel that. Prophet Lut alayhi salam. That's why Allah tells us and mentions that in the Quran about those about the prophets, as, because they're our example. And if you see one of the most difficult things that they have to go through, the thing that it's bitter and it stings, is that innaka la tahdi man ahbabt walakin Allah yahdi man yasha, that you can't guide whoever you love. That is utterly and solely in the domain of God Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Walakin Allah yahdi man yasha, but Allah, he guides whoever he wills. But it's your job, it's your responsibility, it's an obligation on you, brothers and sisters, that you learn your deen so that you can share that with your relatives, so that you can share that with your uncles and your cousins and those people that you know, your co-workers and your classmates. It's an obligation on you. You can't be going 10 years working at a company and you ain't never told that co-worker that's been sitting in that cubicle next to you and you ain't never said nothing about Islam to them. You can't have somebody coming into your store for years and years and years and you know them, they know you, you know their kids, and you ain't never told them about Islam. Or a classmate, and y'all got the same alma mater, and y'all graduated from the same university, and you go back to the family reunion, or excuse me, the class reunion, and you don't never tell them about Islam. But you're friends with them, and you hang out and come to their house for the Super Bowl, and then you going over there, and you visit them and have lunch and so on and so forth, and you ain't never told them about Islam. They're gonna come on the day of judgment, and they're gonna be pulling on your coattails, and they're gonna be saying, this person knew me, this was my cousin, he knew about Islam, or she knew about Islam, or this was my coworker, and he, wallahi, Allah, you're my witness, you saw everything, he never told me once about Islam. Khalas, you might as well throw gasoline on him, because you never told him once about Islam. And that's why I reiterate again why it's so important for us to learn our deen. But again, to go straight back to your question, sister, at that point, it will not be a concern for you then. You won't worry about that, right? Because the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be epitomized on that day where we will see, right? And so someone who goes there, that's where they deserve to be. Allahu musta'an. And that's why we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. And those people who go to paradise, that's from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah knows best. Yes. So I think this was the last question, inshallah. Naam, sister. I'm sorry. Yes, it was this sister on my right. No. No. Mm-hmm. 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 Now, this is actually something that is permissible, right? It is something that is permissible, but this is more of a lengthy discussion, right? But it is something that is permissible. A lot of people think it's not, and the assumption, right? Because what is typically known is that as soon as someone passes, right, that they should immediately, as fast as we can, we should try to put them in the grave. Now, which is true. However, like I said, this is permissible, but there are some details to it that are beyond answering here. No, inshallah. No. And Allah knows best. I'll tell you, then if there's... Yes, if you want to, that would be perfectly fine, inshallah. And we'll get that to you, inshallah. If there's nothing else, wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa akhira da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.